So yesterday's class, we were looking at the profiles through the pack bed at various points in time, as well as looking at it from the perspective of the distance between the pack bed and the length. So we have this dual approach that we're considering. The plots on the left are for the length through the reactor, and they're for the pack bed, I should say, and they're considering the concentration of the solid phase. So that's important, and that's data, the analysis of adsorbents. So it's the concentration CAS that we're considering. And then on the right-hand side, we're considering the effluent or the material leaving the packed bed. And so that's CA, the concentration of resorbable components or adsorbents. So if yesterday's discussion should have properly cleared up maybe what these plots are doing, I posted the paper where these diagrams are from on the course website. So it's this paper here by Lutches. It's a PDF. There's a 2-3 page description of these plots. The notation in that paper is a little different to what I've used, but the descriptions, they will help you understand what's going on if yesterday's discussion missed the details. So I just wanted to talk a bit about one final point before we move on to an example, and that's if we consider these pack beds through time, let's just take one final plot and emphasize one point. So we've got our CAF, our concentration leaving at the exit is CA, and if we're watching that profile here, so this is, recall, fairly easy to observe and measure, so we can measure CA very easily. So it's usually a component of interest, H2S, for example. We can get a detector that is very sensitive to measuring H2S, or if it's some liquid-based adsorbate if we're interested, we can put a spectrometer there in line. It's very easy to monitor CA. And what we'll see is that CA over time, so this is the time axis, will be close to undetectable, we won't read anything, and then we'll just start to rise up. Okay, so this point of rise, this is theta B, or when I'm breaking through. And at that moment, in a practical plant situation, you would shut this valve on right away and stop the bed at that moment in time. So the moment you start to detect this species, you stop the bed, because in most situations the purpose of this bed is to remove that species so that it doesn't contaminate some downstream operation. So it might be a chemical compound that you cannot release into a wastewater stream, and so the government has very stringent limits on what that can be. These are usually in the parts per million range. So the moment you start to see this rise, you know the bed is not going to continue to absorb it. So from that, what you should take is, if you close this valve, if later on you open that valve and you keep feeding material, this curve will just keep going up. Okay? So just closing this valve doesn't change anything in the bed. It simply just pauses the state of the bed at that moment in time. Okay? So theta B is this point where we just start to see that rise. If we keep going, but don't shut that valve, I will see this rise going up, and I will get to a point where we had said yesterday, where CAF, where I mean CAF. So essentially I've now just created a packed pipe and nothing's happening. Whatever's coming in is leaving again. So this moment in time where this approaches CAF, obviously I can keep going after that, but this moment in time we call theta E, the moment where that bed is totally, because no more capacity to load any more solids onto that bed. And then we have the midpoint, typically we'll call the stoichiometric point in time, theta S. And that simply just says it splits the bed into two, that mass transfer zone gets split into half as the division between where LES ends, the length of equilibrium section, and LUB continues on, the length of the unused bed. So it's simply a hypothetical point that we use to track that wave moving through. Now, most often when we're dealing with these problems is we won't plot CA on the vertical axis. We'll plot CA divided by CAF, and we'll wait for this to rise to 0.1. Yes, Mark?
You're feeding from the bottom up.
Yep.
And what is normally driving this, like a pressure drop?
Yeah, you're feeding flow through a pump, or and that will drive it up.
So if you just cut off the valve, wouldn't that cut off like the pressure drop also, or do you just cut off the thing that you want to add to it?
Well, what's coming in here is a mixture, right? So it's a mixture of A and the carrier.
Yeah.
So you cut off the valve, and then there's no more flow through that A anymore.
But I mean, like clearing the rest of it out, like one time.
Okay, so what we'll do is once the valve is shut, our next step is we're going to regenerate that thing.
Yeah.
So I'll show what that does in a minute. Yeah, you're right, there's still material in there. We're going to clear out the bed with a sort of steam or some sort of regenerating fluid to strip off the adsorbate and then regenerate the adsorbates. Okay, so let's take a look then at this particular problem where we're going to plot that data, CA over CAF, and CAF happens to be 600 ppm, parts per million. If you're watching this packed bed over time, CA, you see nothing, and then you see these points. We're sampling at various points in time, and we measure CA divided by CAF, and we see that rise occur. So we're seeing this rise occur at about 3.6 hours over here, and then it takes 6.9 hours to reach to the top CAF. So let's take a look at some questions then around that. What is the breakthrough time?
It's an easy one.
Okay, it's 3.65 hours. The breakthrough point in time is exactly that moment where you first start to see the rise. Now, if this wavefront through the bed, like what's the usable capacity of the bed? So 3.65 is when we're just seeing this rise. If we keep running it, we're seeing it go to 6.9. What's the fraction that's been used up? So maybe this question, let's see, reword it a little bit. Usable capacity of the bed if we have an ideal wavefront. Okay, so if we have an ideal wavefront, I should delete that line. It's an ideal wavefront because there's an ideal wavefront and we're seeing this. No, that's right. Okay, so think
just
of
over 50%.
Yeah. So the way I want you to think of this is, let's take a packed bed. If there was an ideal wavefront, we said that this moves through vertical, right? If we saw that rise at 3.65 hours, you've only used 53% of the bed. So the ratio there of 3.65 divided by 6.9 hours, 53% of the bed has been theoretically used. But we know that not to be the case because our wavefronts don't move as a vertical line. There's this gradient, there's this mass transfer zone that's in the latter half of the bed. Okay, but the way this question is not really a practical question, actually. It's more just for us to think again what an ideal wavefront is and this term usable capacity that comes up. And it's simply just a ratio of when you see that breakthrough time, theta v, divided by theta equilibrium. So if you want to quantify that or algebraically, that usable time, term you'll see sometimes in some of the literature, usable capacity is theta b divided by theta b. What that does is, the reason why that's an interesting concept to consider is it's giving you an idea of the mass transfer zone in the bed. So what is that mass transfer section in the bed look like, or how big is it? Remember, one of our key concerns in when we're designing these beds is we want as much of the bed to be useful for us. Right? So if that wavefront that we're seeing here coming through the bed, by that I mean this distance from that tip to that tip, we would like that ideally to be as squashed down as possible, or as narrow as possible. Right? If that's stretched out very widely, you're able to use much less capacity of the bed. Because our rule is we stop the bed the moment we see that wave front start to leave. So if we can make that as short as possible, or make this S shape, ideally we can make it as steep as possible. So for example, something like that, as opposed to that. This is more desirable here on the left than the one on the right, because we get to use more of the bed. So that ratio of theta B to theta E gives us an idea of what capacity of the bed's being used up at breakthrough point in time. Okay, so to come back then to this question, my intent with this diagram and this question here is to get you to realize that when this breakthrough occurs at time 3.65 hours, you've used up 53% of this bed, but there is some capacity still remaining. However, we cannot use it. We have to stop the bed at that moment and regenerate. If we keep on using the bed, CA will keep coming out the exit, and that's undesirable.
So if you're going to buy another bed...
Sorry, can you...
If you're going to buy another bed, like, let's say something happens to this bed, and you know, like, you don't use the whole bed, would you buy a smaller bed?
Okay.
Or would you ask your supplier if there's a smaller bed?
Would you
ask your supplier if you
could... For a smaller bed?
Yeah.
Okay, so the question is, if you had to purchase an alternative, would you buy a smaller bed or a longer one? Why longer?
Alternative.
But if you had to purchase a second one, which would be better to buy, a shorter bed or a longer bed?
So if you did a longer bed, it would be more time in between regeneration, so it depends on your regeneration cost. So it's a little bit more expensive than maybe a longer bed, so you can run it for longer.
Right.
But if your catalyst, or not your catalyst, but your absorbent is more expensive than maybe like a shorter bed and just regenerate it a lot.
Right. So there's definitely a trade-off between regeneration time and the cost of the absorbent. But I would argue that a longer bed is generally more useful because this wave front moves through at a constant rate. Okay, so it's got a constant S shape or Z shape, depending on your perspective, and it's going to move through the bed. So if you've got a longer bed, it's going to move through, and that breakpoint time is going to be longer for a longer bed. And then you can switch over and regenerate. I'll show you in the next slide or two from here that the fraction of used area goes higher for longer beds. And there's always a portion of the bed that you waste, or called LUB, the length of unused bed, and that on a percentage basis decreases for a longer bed. So we covered this sort of metric concept here. I just want to then show that intuitively for this bed, if 3.65 hours was used up, then, I did need to cover this. Okay, so question four then says, what fraction of the bed capacity is used at theta B? What actual capacity? So an idealized capacity is that we've used 3.65 divided by 6.9, but the actual capacity used up is equal to area 1 plus area 2, as Jeffrey mentioned earlier. I think you had said A1 plus A2. So the actual capacity we've used is this section is fully used, and then this last section of the bed, some percentage of that adsorbent has been used. Not all of it, but because we've got this non-ideal flow in the bed, some fraction of that's been used. And what we can say then is this ratio of time, remember this is time, this area is proportional to time, that area A1 plus A2 is going to be proportional to the lengths used up in the bed.
Two different shapes, like essentially we have the one that's on the screen right now and the one that you drew on the top of the bed there.
Yeah.
Like you have the same S shape, but like reflected.
There are two different views on this. One is looking at the fluid leaving and the other one is looking at the solid adsorbed. So if you go back to this diagram here, the S-shaped curves are on the left, on the right hand side, you should say, and then the Z section goes on the left. They're looking at different perspectives, but they're reflection of the same concept of what's going on.
So CAS and CA.
CAS and CA, exactly. So if we come back to this diagram, area 1 and area 2, the length of used bed, LES and LUB, let's take LES as the length of the equilibrium section, is proportional to 0 to the midpoint through here. Okay. This is symmetrical, this curve. And then LUB is the length of unused bed, is this portion from here onwards. Yes.
I have a question about the number 2 in the example.
Yep.
If you did have an ideal wavefront, doesn't that mean when you see something, your bed is fully used up?
Yeah.
So your usable capacity would be 0?
Your used capacity, or usable.
For an ideal wavefront, if you
yeah.
see theta B, you would
Yeah, so I, that's why I said I needed to reword that question, because what I'm more interested in is the concept of...
Oh, versus
the actual question is a little bit... It's more just I wanted to convey the concept of this. That question, the reason why it's a bit of a mess is because the question last year I introduced the theory with the question at the same time. This year I've introduced the theory yesterday. Now we're looking at the question, so it's not quite consistent there. So, yes.
If you have an ideal wavefront, then your usable bed would be 100%. You have no unusable bed.
Right, because the bed, that wavefront, the moment you see the outlet, you've used up 100% of it. Exactly. But because we've got this smearing out of that wavefront, there's some capacity of the bed that is still unused and some capacity that is used. So if we look back at this diagram, we can take this area as a representation of what is used and what's not used. This area A2 is a symmetrical mirror image of this unused area here, apart from this very small amount of area here. So if we ignore that, this is a mirror image, and we can then say A1 plus A2 divided by that total area gives me an idea of the length of the equilibrium section is going to be proportional to A1 plus A2 divided by the total area. Now, take a look at what your y-axis is. Your y-axis is a number between 0 and 1, and it's dimensionless. So your vertical axis there is always 0 to 1. So total area of this entire diagram is simply what's on your x-axis, multiplied by 1 for your y-axis. So A1 plus A2, then in this example, total area is 6.9, A1 plus A2, you can eyeball it, it's 3.65 plus, I forget off the top of my head what A2 is. Plus 1.55. So that's the portion of the bed that's used there, LES. So what we can say then is LES divided by L, the total length of the bed, is equal to those ratios of areas. So the length of the equilibrium section is that fraction, and that's 75%. So this is 0.75. And let's emphasize that this is at the theta B. Okay. Remember, LES changes with time. We plotted that yesterday. And so when we compute this fraction that's been used up, it's at a snapshot moment in time, at the moment of breakthrough. You've used 75% of the absolute.
Yes. Sorry, how did you calculate A2? Is A2 just half of whatever area is remaining?
It's roughly, right? So the number 1.55 came from using a numerical integration on these points, okay? But it's roughly adds up to 3. So if you take this 1.55 times 2, gets you 3.1. That's roughly this area of this rectangle over here.
Okay.
a little bit of deviation for this unused zone, and numerical error with estimating an integration based on data points rather than the true error. Because we don't know that function, this curve, like the f of x, we don't know that function for it, so that error is just done by numerical integration.
So for our purposes, that's that approximation.
That's good enough. Like, I mean, you're not going to be far off between 75, maybe 73, 77, but that's not a biggie. A lot of this work, as you'll see in separations on packed beds, packed columns, is always empirical and always with error. So the next question then is, if we can relate those areas to the actual bed. So if our lab scale bed was 14 centimeters long, then we can say from this principle of the ratios that 75% was used, 25% is unused, we can then say, well, for a 14 centimeter bed, we can portion it up, so say that the 3.5 centimeters is unused, and therefore 10.5 is the length of the equilibrium section. The reason why that's important is that you can see that length of unused bed, that piece at the end, we're always going to have to account for that. If I go make this bed longer, I'm always going to have to account for that LUB section of the bed. So the thinking is as follows, let's go to the next question. If we wanted a longer breakthrough time, okay, so right now my breakthrough time is 3.65 hours. And that breakthrough time occurs when I'm feeding CAF at a flow QF. And this bed is 14. So the question then is, if we go and make this bed longer, so there's my current length. If I go make it longer, I'm going to get a longer breakthrough time, theta b. So a longer bed, I'm going to get a higher theta b, but I'd like the theta b equal to 7.5 hours. So how much longer should that bed be? Okay, so if right now I'm getting 3.65 hours, and that bed is 14 centimeters, if I desire 7.5 hours, how long should I make the bed? So I want roughly double the breakthrough time, going from 3.65 to 7.5. The gut feel is to simply double 14, right? So if you want double the breakthrough time, the gut feel says, well, we need to double our bed. But that's not entirely true. The way to think about it is 14 centimeters gets you a breakthrough time of 3.65 hours. At 3.65 hours, you have a mass transfer zone. And then this is LUB, and this is LES for your 14 centimeter bed. And that proportion, in particular, LES is equal to 10.4 centimeters, and LUV is 3.5. So this 10.5 centimeter section of the bed will get you a breakthrough time of 3.65 hours. If you desire a breakthrough time of 7.5 hours, you should ratio the LESs and not the full length of the bed. So take this formula then and say, if we desire a certain theta b, and I know my current theta b, my breakthrough time, I know my current LES, I can ratio those lengths of the LESs, not ratio the length of the entire bed. So if I plug in my values that I know here, I know these three values down here, I can calculate I need 21.6 centimeters. And then what I need to do is I need to add on the LUB from the lab scale. So LUV from the lab was 3.5 centimeters. That remains the same. LUV does not change whether if you're just simply lengthening the bed. So all I'm doing is adding on a portion. I simply take this LUV that I have here at the end of the existing bed, and I will have that same LUV on the new bed. So just move that over, but then my bed portion stays up. And the reason why we can do that is because as long as the lengthened bed is being operated at the same conditions, so the same inlet flow rate QF, and that bed diameter remains the same, that wavefront simply just propagates through for a longer time. We can just add on the LED. Yes?
Can you explain if you knew that your LUV is the same every time, couldn't you just like leave a space where you actually have no catalyst and allow that to go through? It's not really being used at all.
But it's a hypothetical pipe that's not being used, because it is actually being used. That mass transfer zone is more, it's more like gray area where the pipe is used and unused. So if you had no catalyst, you had none there.
Right.
You had zero ones. Yeah, so you do need it.
Your percentage changed, but essentially the mass of catalyst that is unused is the exact same, no matter how long your bed is.
Exactly right. As long as you're feeding it at the same flow profile. If you increase this flow profile here, that shape of the curve would change, and you need to repeat the experiment. Okay, and then what you can show that for this longer bed, keeping all the flow conditions the same, you actually get to use a higher fraction of it. Now 88% of the bed gets used rather than the original 75.
Is that 24.5 supposed to be 25.1?
It should be 25.1, sorry. And then that ratio will change as well. Sorry, it's a change from last year. So 24.5 down here at the bottom is changed to 25.1, and then that number will change slightly. Okay, then the final piece of design information we need is how much catalyst is required. And what we can do is a mass balance over the bed from time zero to time theta b. So the mass balance says that if you operate the bed for theta b minutes or seconds, then you would have fed in a certain amount of material. So the amount of material you would have fed in is equal to QF, that feed flow rate, multiplied by the concentration, multiplied by the time that you're feeding and flow. That gets you your total mass of A into the bed. So the left hand side of the equation is mass of A into the bed. The right hand side of the equation is telling you how much has been taken up by the bed and adsorbed. And so we've got our adsorbent there. That adsorbent has a bulk density of a certain mass of adsorbent per meter cube of occupied space. So that's a number that the supplier will give you for how you pack the adsorbent into the bed. You can have a certain mass per meter cube occupied space. We know what CAS is from our isotherm. And then we can calculate, the only unknown would be A times LES. Now, you would either know what your A is if you've got a given column in mind already or purchased, and then LES would be your unknown. Okay, so we can solve for that and then calculate how much catalyst we need to purchase. Adsorbent we need to purchase. Okay, so very straightforward equation then, once you have your isotherm information to give you CAS, the superscript E. And you need to know your breakthrough time theta b as well from a lab experiment. So fairly straightforward to figure that information out and purchase the right amount of material. So there's this problem over here. It's actually unrelated to the topic we've just been discussing. I will leave it for you to work on at home. There's only one point that I want to emphasize over here, is that sometimes our concentrations, Ca, will be expressed in parts per million, ppm, because we're typically dealing with such small quantities of material. So that's maybe a new set of units that you haven't dealt with or haven't dealt with often. I'm not sure. We typically, up to now, of course, dealt with CA as units of grams per meter cubed or mass per unit volume. But if we're dealing with units of ppm, the way to work with it is, for example, let's take 60 parts per million says 60 grams of A divided by 10 to the 6 grams of fluid. So in this case, we've got water, I believe is the fluid, or simply an aqueous stream. So it's 10 to the 6 grams of fluid. So it's a mass basis, parts per million based on mass. So in that case, once you've got 60 grams of A per 10 to the 6 gram fluid, if you want to get into units of grams per meter cubed, you'd multiply by the density of the fluid. So it's easily convertible between the two sets of conditions.
So if you're going to try and optimize like the situation, like you find a flow rate that would give you like a good throughput, but as well as not change, give you also like a steep curve?
Yeah, so coming back to the design of the bed, and there's several parameters that you have free as the engineer if you're designing a new bed. But most often we come to the case where there's an existing bed. Okay, so then you determine your profile ahead of time, and then that profile is very much a function of the length of Q, as you said. If I slow Q down, I'm going to get a very different wavefront than if it's really fast.
You just have to know what
to do. Yeah. So a lot of experimentation. Okay, then the final step is once we've loaded the bed up, we need to regenerate it. So let's take a look. There's two ways we can regenerate the bed. One is by the temperature swing and the other is by a pressure swing. What I'll do is I'll refer to the next plot to explain the temperature swing first. So if we've loaded up the bed, we've got this horizontal axis here, which is PA or CA, depending on your units. So recall we can always exchange between PA and CA using this formula that PA equals CA times RT. So concentration units or partial pressure units, doesn't matter here on the horizontal axis. And that's my isotherm related to CAS, what's on the bed. So at my loading temperature, I will get a certain point of operation. So when I'm loading onto that packed bed, I'm here at this concentration where I'm adsorbing, and I can calculate the equilibrium concentration. So a temperature swing, if we want to regenerate the bed, we want to move that adsorbent off the bed. So I've loaded it on at this point. So a temperature swing says, move the isotherm lower. So if I move this isotherm lower and lower, that equilibrium concentration on the solid drops. So A actually will desorb the solid phase. And so we can achieve that by most often raising the temperature of our environment will push this isotherm down. And if we wait long enough to equilibrium, our material will come off the packed bed. So we do exactly that. We raise the temperature, this isotherm curve shifts lower. The higher the temperature, the lower these curves move. And an additional way in which we move material off that solid is by displacing it. So A is adsorbed on. If we can introduce another molecule that will force A off the surface, we can additionally regenerate it. And so typically we'll use steam. So steam will perform both functions. If I pump that bed in with steam, I'm raising the temperature of the bed, and the water is going to displace A often. Most often steam will displace that molecule A. And so those two mechanisms are used to move A off the solid phase and regenerate that solvent for another use. So that's a temperature swing. And it can be expensive, right? Because you have to now use steam and adsorbents, you're now raising the temperature. That adsorbent is going to pick up heat as well. So think of activated carbon or zeolite, you're raising the temperature of that solid. You do this enough times, you raise, lower temperature, that solid is going to break down into finer and finer particles. Then you're going to experience problems with pressure drops across the bed, and it's destructive on the adsorbent. So there's a finite number of times that you can do your temperature swing. So what several years ago, some of the big oil companies discovered that instead of swinging the temperature, they can swing the pressure. What that simply says is, especially for gas-phase species, is let's not change the temperature, let's just move to a different region on the isotherm. Okay, and what they'll actually do is they'll draw a vacuum in the packed bed, and that will pull the solute off, or the adsorbate off the bed. So you swing your pressure lower and higher by going from vacuum to high pressure to vacuum to high pressure. So that's a little bit more gentle on that adsorbent, so you can extend the life of the pressure swing. Rather than temperature. Now, the typical approach is to have two or more beds in parallel in a plant. So you've got your feed coming in to one packed bed, and then the second packed bed is being regenerated. So this one is being loaded. And this bed is being regenerated. And once this bed is fully loaded, you will close this valve off and you feed the material to the regenerated bed. And while this one is now loading, so exchange operation, you regenerate that, so you can flip between the two beds. You may have three or four, so there's always one or more beds being regenerated and recycled between them. So we learned about that in 4N as well. But one way we can often get around that is by trying to create a continuous process from a batch process. And here's an example of that. It's a fairly intricate diagram, so let's just follow the flow through the system. You've got your air coming in with adsorbent, so the solvent is your material you wish to remove, that's your adsorbate. And we cool the air down. And this is important. We cool down because, remember, high temperatures are prone to have lower equilibrium. So if we can operate at lower temperatures, we can adsorb more solvent. So if we cool that material down, that works in our favor. We drive it in through that fan, and it's going to contact this rotary device at the top, which is loaded with adsorbent. So inside these two circles, these segments, inside here is your adsorbent is packed in. So your airstream with solvent comes in and contacts that adsorbent and is forced through in this direction, through the packed bed into the interior. So in the interior, you've got, you're pulling off that stream, and this solvent will adsorb in the packed bed over here in between the two circles. This rotates around, and as it rotates, it picks up more and more solvent. At some point, you want to regenerate that packed bed. So this is the last opportunity where you can load solvent onto the bed. This moves around to this position, and at this position here, this segment is currently being regenerated. What we do is we'll force steam through this inner tube, will come and force steam through that packed segment in the opposite direction. So now you've got steam being forced down. It's going to displace the adsorbent and raise the temperature at the same time. So what's leaving here in that is steam with the solvent. We'll condense that out, bubble it through water to separate the steam as much as possible and the condensed water phase. And then this is a very solvent-rich stream passing out. So you recover that solvent or that species A. This segment will move over, and it's then got a chance to be reused again. So you're loading up, regenerating, and you can operate on a continual basis here. So an interesting rotary device for that. This is another one that's actually quite interesting. This was patented by UOP, and the speaker that we had in 4N the other day was Bob Kolpiger, his company that he worked for was this one. And this is one, if you go look up the patents for the Zorbex column, that's the company he was working for at the time. And the zeolites and the materials that he spoke about in that class was exactly the ones used in these columns. So kind of interesting, I only put two and two together after the fact, and I was looking at some of this material on Zorbex columns again today and yesterday. So there's a lot going on here. It's an interesting column. It's used not only for adsorption, but it's used in many other areas. But essentially what it does is, it's a fairly clever idea. It recognizes that if you move your solids around, you're going to damage them. That's the last thing we want to do to an adsorbent that we've spent a lot of money on. So we don't want to move our solids around. But what we do want as engineers is, we know that countercurrent operation is desirable. If you move your liquids and your solids in countercurrent from each other, you can increase the usage of that adsorbent. So what this does is, it simulates countercurrent motion without moving the solids. So how does it do it? Well, it's what's called a simulated moving bed, or an SMB. And what we actually do is, we only move the liquid. Liquid doesn't mind being moved around, but it's not a problem. So we'll move our liquid phase and pump it around this direction. Our solid remains stationary in these 12 trays. There's 12 instances here at the moment. And what we'll do is, we'll move our feed point from one tray to the next. So by moving our feed points, it simulates the movement of solid without actually moving the solid. So let's take a look at how it does that. At one particular moment in time, this might be the configuration as shown. We're feeding material on the first tray, extracting on the fourth tray, and then feeding over here, and our raffinate leaves. So what do I mean by that? Let's take a look. Here's my feed coming in with A that I wish to remove. So it's coming in and it's being fed. This valve C is a rotary valve that will rotate and make sure that the feed enters at this location. This location has some adsorbent in it, and this feed is then driven into the column at that point. This pump is driving material around the column in this clockwise direction, so this feed will adsorb onto the adsorbent in this tray and then get forced through to the next, to the next, to the next. And hopefully at this point, after three or four trays, most of A has been adsorbed. And so what we'll do is, we'll draw off from that tray a portion of the flow and call that the raffinate stream. Same terminology as liquid-liquid extraction. Simply says that the stream leaving here should have low amounts of the adsorbate A. So what's then being pumped around is relatively low quantities of A. We've hopefully stripped most of it off and it gets sent to the raffinate stream. So we pump that liquid around, or that vapor around, and then we'll introduce a desorbent. A desorbent in this instance might be steam, for example. Steam gets entered in at this point, and this bed at that moment will regenerate the bed with that steam, and the steam will drive off whatever we've adsorbed, and it gets pulled out at this stream called the extract. What we'll do is, we'll operate the bed in this configuration for a period of time, for a couple of minutes, and then what we'll do is, we'll switch everything down by one level. So the desorbent then will move one down, the extract point will move one down, the feed will move one down, and the raffinate, because this is at the bottom tray right now, in fact the raffinate moves up to the top, we draw the raffinate over there. We'll operate there for a few more minutes, then move everything down once more, once more, once more. So what you can see is, in fact, you load up, if you think back two, three steps ago, this was a part where we were loading up. Eventually, we'll bring the steam down, 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 and we'll start to strip off a part that's been loaded up prior. So in that manner, it's quite clever how this happens, is that you're moving essentially the solids in a fictitious way without moving them. So you're getting countercurrent operation of your solid phase relative to your liquid phase for your vapor stream without actually having to move the solids. Okay, so they patented this thing to death. They patented that valve that does the movement and the transitions between the phases, the stages, I should say, is heavily patented and protected. So, and for good reason, right? Because this is valuable technology. Then the last part of the flow sheet is says, well, we now want to recover our adsorbent, our adsorbate, our species A, and we want to, in some cases, the desorbent here is used, is valuable as well. So sometimes it's you don't really care to recover that, but sometimes your desorbent is another chemical that you wish to recover, so you'll have distillation columns for that recovery step. Okay, so I thought that was a pretty neat way to end off this section because it brings in some of the concepts from liquid extraction. So you can start to see why this terminology is used here. And this moving column is also used for those types of applications. It's used for chromatography, it's used for ion exchange, and any sort of countercurrent separator can be reconfigured to be running this column. So this company has sold hundreds of these for various applications.
And this will continuously run for a loop.
This will run continuously, but it gets away from that batch mode. But internally in the column, each of these trays is running as a batch in a continuous mode. Okay, so we'll leave it there. We'll start drying on